Science began when man began to observe and to make note of his observations. In the Stone Age, man lived on the flesh of animals which he could slay. Primitive men were creatures of superstition, and probably, like the practitioners of voodoo who made wax models of their enemies and stick pins in them, they made drawings of the animals they hunted, in the act of being slain, and in the hope that the wish would be fulfilled. And so we have representations of bison in the cavern of Meaux in the south of France, which are faithful anatomical studies, with the arrow penetrating exactly where the heart should be. This, apart from any superstition, showed a useful know-how in the killing of animals. Then men noticed that the grains in certain grasses were especially good to eat, that from seed they could grow new grasses, that if they chose a suitable bit of ground, they could grow lots of such grasses, and that if they scraped the ground, the plants would root better. And so they became tillers, applying the science of their observations. But agriculture depends on the seasons, another observation of the early scientists. And they needed a calendar to help them to sow and to reap. They noticed that certain stars had a fixed relationship to the sun, which corresponded with their seasons of growth. And their preoccupation with the stars for this simple purpose of living led them to more, well, shall we say, academic observations. 5,000 years ago, before or about the time when Bishop Usher would have us believe that Abram left Ur of the Chaldees, astronomers there in Ur could predict an eclipse as recurring at intervals of 18 years and 11 days. Complete records extending over 360 years have been found at Ur, and in them the evidence that a Chaldean, without the help of accurate instruments now at our disposal, had worked out the length of the year as 365 days, 6 hours, 15 minutes, and 41 seconds. Only 26 minutes and 26 seconds too long by our calculation. Such calendar-making was characteristic of most cultures. The Mayan, the Aztec calendars, are half a world apart from those of the Middle East, but they're just as remarkable in their observations. When the Nile flooded, it swept away natural landmarks which might have divided one tiller's ground from another, so some method had to be devised by which the land could be marked out every year. Now, you know, that was the origin of practical geometry. The Egyptians invented a set square to give a right angle. They did this by knotting a rope in lengths of 3 units, 4 units, and 5 units, the units being based on the length from the tip of the middle finger to the elbow. And then they pegged this rope out on the ground at the knot. From such practical devices, the Greeks later produced their logical systems of geometry, although Chinese prints of 1000 BC show that the Orientals anticipated the famous theorem of Pythagoras, that the square on the longest side of a right-angled triangle is the sum of the squares of the other two. And the excavations at Tell el-Harmel, near Baghdad, showed that much of Euclid was anticipated by 2,000 years. Then, when men began to congregate in communities and to trade, they needed numbers. The handiest way was, like a child of school, counting the fingers. So we have, from the earliest time, had 10-finger decimal counting. All men notched sticks, like the bad man of the cowboy film, notching his gun to keep a tally of his victims. Then they found it was easier to count pebbles, and the next stage was to have the pebbles in a convenient form. So they strung them together as the abacus, or counting frame. The Mexicans and the Peruvians were using the abacus before the Spaniards arrived in the New World. The Chinese and Egyptians possessed the abacus 1,000 years before the Christian era. The Romans borrowed the abacus from the Etruscans. Having tallied up the score, it was necessary to make a note of it. So numerals were introduced. The numerals we use today are derived from the Hindus, and probably are the initials of the Hindu words conveying 2, 3, 4, and so on. And 0 was probably the symbol of the unhatched egg.